What I'll be doing for this blog is giving an explanation on how to use the accelerated version of the Lorentz transformation equations. And the example that I will be giving will be how to deal with an observer who's undergoing constant proper acceleration, because the case of the constant proper acceleration has been analyzed, and the result for transforming his coordinates to an inertial frame's coordinates is known, and we can compare the results, whereas the more general equations that I have developed here are for transforming an accelerated observer's coordinates to an inertial frame observer's coordinates when his velocities and accelerations are completely arbitrary. In setting up these transformation equations, I've defined an R vector as so. It's a 3 vector, not a true vector of relativity, and a beta 3 vector as so, where the x, y, and z components of these velocities here are to be expressed as functions of the proper frame coordinate time. And once you do that, then these transformation equations will give you the coordinate transformation from an arbitrarily accelerated observer's coordinates to an inertial framed, unprimed frame observer's coordinates. Now, in order to analyze this problem, I'm going to define what I mean by a couple of different types of velocities and accelerations. The type of velocity and acceleration most people are used to using from Newtonian dynamics are coordinate velocity and coordinate acceleration. The coordinate velocity is a change in something's position with respect to your coordinate's time. In this case, your coordinate will be that of an inertial frame. Your lab frame will not be accelerated. It will be an unprimed frame. And the coordinate acceleration will be the change in its coordinate velocity with respect to the change in your coordinate's time as well. Now, those are not true vectors. The true vectors which we'll be interested in looking at for this problem are the velocity for a vector and the acceleration for a vector in particular. The velocity for a vector is given by a change in position with respect to a change in the proper time of whatever you're observing moving about. And the position there actually is not a true vector either. If it were a true vector, then in general relativity, there would be an affine connection, a Christoffel symbol component to this four-vector velocity equation, which doesn't show up because the position is not a true vector in relativity, and like some texts will tell you, the four-vector velocity is a true vector. The four-vector acceleration for inertial frames will be given by the change in four-vector position or four-vector velocity with respect to a change in proper time. It will not have a Christoffel symbol component to it. That'll be zero for our frame because we're not going to be accelerated. We're going to be comparing our frame's coordinates with somebody who is accelerated, whose four-vector velocity is that capital U. Now, in defining the acceleration four-vector in that way, I'm able to work it down to this expression, where in the last step I only make one restriction to the case that I'm analyzing, and that's that the coordinate velocity of what we're analyzing be in the same direction as the coordinate acceleration. And that's only in the last step for this expression for the four-vector acceleration. Now, we're going to introduce the metric tensor at this point for special relativity in order to define lengths for vectors, and particularly the length of the acceleration for vector, I'll define in this manner. And using that metric tensor and the Einstein summation convention here, you get the second equation as being what you'll get for the length of the acceleration for vector. And I do a bunch of algebra here, which you can either pause and work through, or you can just skip down to the end, which is where what I'm really interested in getting to, which is that the length of the acceleration for vector is equal to gamma squared times the magnitude of the change in speed with respect to a change in proper time. Now I'm going to change variables to rapidity because it will simplify the rest of this problem. And rapidity, theta, will be defined by the hyperbolic tangent of rapidity theta being equal to beta, which is the velocity over the speed of light. Changing variables to rapidity, we can then come down to this last equation for the expression for the length of the acceleration for vector in terms of rapidity. And in defining the length of the acceleration for vector the way that I did, it is the same value for the length of that for vector according to all frames. Now the transformation equations for the going from the accelerated observer's coordinates to the inertial frame observer's coordinates that I've given were for arbitrary directions for his velocity and for arbitrary accelerations. However, for this problem, since we're comparing to some commonly known results, we're going to look for the case of constant proper acceleration, in which case we can choose the case that his motion is solely along the x prime direction, in which case the accelerated version of the Lorentz transformation equations reduces to these top two equations, which if you consider the case of constant gamma and beta, you'll see will immediately reduce to the well-known Lorentz transformation equations for constant velocity. We've gone and changed variables to rapidity theta, so we can go ahead and replace those into this expression. And we're considering the case of constant proper acceleration, where from here on out I'll call alpha. So we have this first order differential equation for theta, and solving that, the rapidity theta is given by alpha times the proper time divided by the speed of light. So now we can go to the accelerated version of the Lorentz transformation equations and write those expressions of theta in terms of the coordinate time of the accelerated observer in order to do those antiderivatives. And once we've done those antiderivatives, and then we've gone and afterwards chosen some appropriate initial conditions, we get these last two equations as being the coordinate transformation equations between the accelerated observer's coordinates that are primed and the unaccelerated observer's coordinates, the inertial frame coordinates that are unprimed on the left. And these can be compared to Meisner, Thorne, and Wheeler's gravitation and Rindler's general relativity and others that have looked at these particular cases.